To introduce to you Lena DeMarco, Regional Director with Bell, and she will introduce Chair Alan Caslin. Bell believes in giving back to the community. Giving is a social responsibility, and Bell does its best to live up to that commitment. They support a wide range of community initiatives in addition to Bell's Let's Talk mental health initiative. For example, in 2014, they invested more than $20 million in the communities they serve, including workplace mental health programs. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Lena DeMarco.
Thank you, Mishka. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. On behalf of all my colleagues at Bell, let me say how pleased we are to support the work of the Greater Niagara Chamber of Commerce by supporting this luncheon today. It's important for all of us here to connect with each other, compare notes, and look for new opportunities to build our businesses. It's also critical of all of us to understand the local political environment, to hear the plans and priorities of the leaders of our community. In that way, we all have a much better chance to work together toward the common goal of making Niagara an even better place to work, live, and raise a family. And now to introduce our featured speaker, who really does not need any introduction. Alan Caslin was elected chair of Niagara Region in December of 2014, after serving 4 years as a regional councillor for St. Catharines, where he was a member of the Business Liaison Committee. Mr. Caslin worked for 20 years at General Motors in St. Catharines, taking on a number of roles, most recently as facilities manager in St. Catharines. Before going to GM, he spent 15 years as a project manager for the large consulting firm Acres International. Married to Anita and raising two children, Kevin and Kelly, Mr. Caslin has been actively involved in youth sports as a volunteer and coach for more than 15 years. If you've been involved in Port de Luis softball, CYO basketball, or Jets soccer, to name just a few, you probably have run into him in coaching or volunteering. He is also a past member of several community boards, including the YMCA of Niagara, United Way of St. Catharines, and the District and the St. Catharines Jets Soccer Club. He was also a member of the Board of Directors of Meridian Credit Union. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Niagara Regional Chair Alan Caslin.
Well, what a great crowd we have here today. 2015, 2016, let's think about it. Go train all the way to Niagara Falls. Yes, yes. 0% tax increase in 2016, how about that? And now working on intermunicipal transit. I think it was a pretty good year. It's great to be here today, and it's great to see so many friends here today as well. You know, I have been listening to you, and I just wanted to share something with you. I think my guys have queued up a video for you to have a look at. So why don't you turn your attention to the screen.
Hello, folks. Thanks for joining me today. I just wanted to let you know that I have been listening and following your tweets. In fact, my staff was so kind that they put them together for me today to have a look at and review with you in person to make it really personal. So So, Grant LaFleche, Alan Caslin is 8th place in the council race, not far behind 6th and 7th places. Could he be the dark horse? I guess so. Tiffany Roosh. Kind of get tired of seeing Alan Caslin's face everywhere, just saying. Mike Garrett. We all know Alan Caslin is the devil, Jim. Mike Garrett, Regional Chair Caslin, 0 mentions of Veg Fest, 2 mentions of Rib Fest. Sorry. Gino, Chair Caslin, suddenly lost his tongue suddenly can't speak to media. What possess? What P? What's POS?
Piece of
Jerick Aslan suddenly lost his tongue. Suddenly can't speak to media. What a piece of sh**. And he's chair of the Niagara Region. We should demand he resign. Rob Norris, Niagara Next. Don't you love contradictory bull coming from Chair Castle and Niagara Region? Rob Houle, underway a regional council. New chair Alan Caslin looks dapper in his new chain of office. I think so too. Laura Ipp, Chair Caslin, I've been listening, and still I am. I wouldn't call his speech standing up, unfortunately. Not sure. Sean Polden, this is weak. Should be calling the Liberals out on a promise to bring GO Train to Niagara in 2015 instead of rolling over. Looks like GO Train's coming. Thanks, Sean. Julia McLaren, I spy with my eye at Caslin standing with all the Liberal candidates. Sorry. How much over the 10-minute limit does Chair Caslin let Petrovsky go? Just a little bit. Mike Garrett, why bother with GO service, Alan Caslin? Can you give anyone a ride to Toronto? Give anyone a ride to Toronto in a Chevy Avalanche? Mike Garrett again. Chair Caslin and Bullet News can go f*** themselves.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the feedback. Well, sometimes it's good, sometimes not so good, but thank you for the feedback. Anyways, I'm glad to be here. I'd like to welcome each and every one of you today to this lunch, and special thanks to Mishka Balsam and the GNCC and all the other chambers that are supporting today's event. Today I want to talk about the fact that we are, in fact, aligned. We're aligned as a region, we're aligned as a government. A few weeks ago, I joined the Southern Tier mayors in Port Coburn at their annual luncheon. All the mayors spoke about a renewed sense of alignment among Niagara's municipalities in the region. And I echo that position here today. Our region is aligned, we are focused, and we are working for you. Alignment can only occur by listening, by working together, and putting aside parochialism. I've seen this occur many times in the past year, and we'll continue to encourage the local elected officials to strive for that alignment. More than ever, our councils, mayors, towns, our cities, our federal and provincial representatives are pushing forward on projects in the best interest of Niagara. This benefits us, it benefits residents, and it benefits you, the community leaders and business owners. We're taking a proactive approach in the way we do business today. Our council is not waiting on the bench for a chance to get into the game. Over the past year, our council has been moving forward proactively in pursuit of new funding investments and new increased growth and new opportunities. For example, when we heard that Porter, you all know Porter? When we heard that Porter couldn't keep flying into Toronto Airport with the jets that they wanted to purchase, we immediately got on the road and went to visit them to talk about what Niagara District Airport had for them, to see down in Niagara. When we heard that GE Power and Water planned to stop manufacturing engines in Waukesha, Wisconsin, we planned to open a new facility here in Canada, we immediately got on the phone and we started talking to them as well. Mayors Diodati and Senzik and I met with Elise Allen, President and CEO of GE Canada, to highlight the very attractive transportation, market access, incentives, and to make Niagara a great place to do business. We all know that Niagara remains a great place for GE's relocation. As you can see, rather than hoping for better, our proactive approach means that we're capitalizing on these opportunities. Let's talk about transit for a minute. Anybody heard of the GO Train? Anybody heard of the GO Train? Come on, of course you have. You all know that that's a key priority for our council in that two-way, all-day GO Train service from Toronto all the way to, Jim? Niagara Falls is what we're looking for. And without a doubt, I'm very excited that our advocacy with the Minister of Transportation is finally starting to pay off. Let's face it, for the first time ever, we've been mentioned in the provincial budget. That would be page 71, paragraph 2, line 3. Not that I was looking, but I was. We're really excited. There was four projects in the province that were announced in the provincial budget, and we're really excited to be one of them. 2 weeks ago, we heard from Infrastructure Minister Brad Duguid right here in Niagara to confirm the province's commitment of GO Train all the way to Niagara Falls. Let's talk about intermunicipal transit for a minute, because that's something that's high on our radar. Of course, we know that projects like GO Train require us to do our part, and we recognize that there's local work to do. For that reason, the region's three largest municipalities have been working hard on developing a plan to bring those together and develop one agency to deliver transit services in Niagara. So why is IMT, or intermunicipal transit, a priority? IMT is a priority because it moves people to work, to school, and to health services. It helps support the GO Rail to Niagara. It facilitates economic development. It contributes to a high quality of life for Niagara residents. It supports sustainable development. And IMT will be related to other critical initiatives, including Niagara's Transportation Master Plan. This plan is a comprehensive planning document that will define policies and infrastructure improvements needed to address Niagara's transportation needs now all the way through 2041. To carry out Regional Council's direction, a three-part plan was developed in January 2016. This plan will be updated by the working group and will be on the Niagara Region website. The three components of the plan are as follows. One, to determine the preferred options for intermunicipal transit beyond its current pilot. The working group is currently procuring services and is to assist us in developing options that are integrated with Niagara and the GTHA. This is different from past efforts because it employs a system-wide approach that encompasses all resources in all municipalities that offer transit service in Niagara. We are beyond just talking on this issue. The past week, the IMT Working Group had awarded an RFP to Dillon Consulting Team. This team includes top names in the industry, including the former GO Transit president, Gary McNeil, to help us determine the best options for the future of our collective integrated system. And we know that Gary McNeil was very successful in helping us with our GO Transit business case. More than establishing routes that connect cities, it's about utilizing everything to its fullest potential in all of our transit systems involved. Council outlined a 20-month work plan for the transit providers to come back to council and with a solution on what we can do. It is anticipated that options will be put forward by the working group before the end of this year. The second component is to continue to make the pilot the best it can be to ensure better services for Brock University and Niagara College. Earlier this year, myself and many of the regional councillors met with students from Brock University Student Union and Niagara College to understand their needs when it comes to municipal transit. Traveling on the local system gave us a clear understanding of what the students' needs are and how we need to shape the system to work for residents and students alike. Number three is participating in uncovering new technologies, new leading-edge technologies, and service delivery arrangement. The group is investigating new options to allow for easier fare payment and system-wide trip planning. They will find solutions for delivering transit service more efficiently than buses. So I applaud the federal government's recent budget outlining investments for infrastructure of $120 billion over the next 10 years. That's huge. $11.9 billion over 5 years was allocated to modernize reliable public transit. $3.4 billion was available through new public transit infrastructure to provide up to 50% of eligible costs for projects like this. I look forward to working with our municipal members of parliament and to ensure that our intermunicipal projects are eligible, first of all, and well considered as these funds are made available. Let's talk about spending, because quite frankly, as a council, we are reforming the way we spend your money. In 2015, Council voted for a 0% budget increase in 2016, and our 2017 planning has already started. This year, we are planning a robust dialogue with the community organizations and business input such as your own. This year, thanks to our hardworking Budget Chair David Barrick and Vice Chair April Jeffs and our Council, residents saw a 0% budget increase on the regional portion of their tax bill in 2016. How about that, 0% increase? Yes, what's more is the 2016 operating budget maintains programs and services at levels that they are today and provides funding for investments in new areas that will support economic prosperity, including this list. And listen to this, $1 million in investments for intermunicipal transit in the GTA corridor, in addition to the GO Transit money, $1.1 million to promote employment, residential growth in partnership with municipalities and private sector investors. Building a healthy and safe Niagara with an additional $2 million in increased investments to better serve the residents of Niagara. In the 2016 capital budget, Regional Council also approved $165 million to support significant infrastructure projects, including $20 million to open lands for business and residential development, something we sorely need, $10 million to advance GO Train transit across Niagara, $50 million to improve Niagara's regional roads, bridges, including $9 million for road resurfacing. Where is the CAA's worst roads list now when you need it? We are putting our money where our mind is right now. $11.6 million to build affordable housing for residents, including funds received from the federal and provincial governments. The 2015 and 2016 chair and vice chair were recently elected for another 2 years, and I'm confident that they're going to be putting their minds to strategically invest in Niagara the way that they did in 2016, being mindful of where the money comes from. Let's talk about audits for a minute. Audits are important. In 2015, Council decided to examine regional projects using value for money audits, or VFM, to provide certainty to elected officials that your public dollars are being spent responsibly. These audits are used to find efficiencies, ensure fairness, and provide transparency. We're looking to make sure that we've done the right things right, that we had followed processes and done things fairly, that the funds have not been squandered, misappropriated, and that we're always looking for ways to improve. In 2015, Council approved VFM audits on the following. The Burgoyne Bridge construction project, up to the contractor selection and award. And as a direct result of that, you should know that the audit showed that we needed an overhaul on our project management system, which we're in the middle of undertaking now. Secondly, the Broad Oak and Finch Street regional housing developments. And thirdly, winter and general road maintenance are things that we're going to be looking at. As part of the audit process, we review all opportunities for improvement, which can include consideration of alternative service delivery methods. Alternative service delivery is ASD. Niagara is embracing this as a new model on how to operate assets and services. Anybody heard of ASD? Yeah, seeing some nods around the table. Well, wait a minute, you're responsible for it. ASD looks at alternative ways to obtain critical infrastructure assets or deliver services other than the traditional model that we're used to. From a capital or asset perspective, the traditional method for the region is to build an asset under a design, bid, build approach. Other methods may include formal partnerships or co-developments to acquire an asset. From a service perspective, alternative arrangements could include items such as an outsourced arrangement, a concession arrangement, or some other form of commercial arrangement, such as a joint venture, a partnership, or some other corporate entity. Under Council's strategic priorities, $1 billion in corporate assets have been identified for potential ASD audits. During the priority setting process, Council identified long-term care home redevelopment and social housing as priority candidates for applicability to ASD. Let's talk about initiatives that we've been through in the past year. And there are many, but I just want to talk about a couple right here. This year, we are welcoming Syrian refugees to Niagara. I'm really excited about that because growth is so important to our community. Regional Council took a bold step of offering up $25,000 in funds to match the funds raised by Niagara residents to support Syrian refugees coming to Niagara. How about that? $25,000 for Syrian refugees. Yes. So, you know, there was significant support from Council for the motion to assist the Syrian refugees, but really, the thanks go out to you. I'm so pleased that Niagara residents stepped up to the plate and surpassed that amount in matching donations for this great cause. Thanks to Niagara. Overall, a great indication that Niagara is a welcoming and compassionate community and is willing to support those who need a hand up. Until April 30th, we are receiving applications from groups and organizations seeking to use these funds, and you can find more information about that on our region's website. Let's talk about another initiative that's so important to me in particular. We need to talk about youth retention in Niagara. The future of youth in Niagara is critical to our ongoing success. Do you agree? We've heard that, right? I've heard that from business, I've heard that from schools, I've heard that from everybody, that keeping our young people in Niagara is critically important. We need to attract and retain top talent that are graduating from our schools, Brock University and Niagara College as well. One of the priorities in our strategic plan is to develop a joint strategy on youth retention developed with the post-secondary institutions. There are three parts to this plan, and let me just run through them with you. The first part is development, distribution, and analysis of a youth retention and attractment engagement efforts targeted at post-secondary students, working young adults, and employers. Here's what we did. We upped our online engagement efforts and received over 1,000 responses from professionals and post-secondary students. We interviewed numerous employers across the region on what they do to attract talent and what they're looking for in talent. We partnered with the Niagara Community Observatory and published an update to the policy brief, "The Young Are the Restless," outlining recent changes in our youth demographic. The second area of focus was planning a one-day forum to bring together key stakeholders right here and organizations and the community who are interested in youth retention. The U35 Forum was held in November and engaged over 140 stakeholders with many business leaders Niagara youth in attendance. The key themes by the forum participants were identified as selling Niagara and creating jobs. Let's face it, we need jobs and we need to sell Niagara. That's what we have to do. The working group determined the goal was to connect youth with industry and industry with youth. We found there was a disconnect there. We need to put them together. This will be accomplished in a two-pronged approach. Connecting job seekers with job opportunities, like I just said, and creating an environment where Niagara is the best place to build your career and young people want to stay here. The third area of focus is investigating the potential for a rotational apprenticeship internship program in partnership with the municipality and private sector partners. The Niagara region is proposing a partnership with public and private business leaders to develop an engineer-in-training program. This program will be an internship program that addresses gaps in the labor-ready workforce, provides mentorship to young people, and supports graduate readiness for career entry. Consultations with potential partners to design and participate in the program are currently underway. Building Niagara's capacity and co-ops is an important aspect of retaining our youth. It is something that each and every one of you can participate in by creating those opportunities where possible. It's important. Try and do it, please. Let's talk about one more initiative. Let's talk about the foreign trade zone. Has anybody ever heard of FTZ? FTZ? Yeah, FTZ, that's big for Niagara. Our economic development team has been working closely with our provincial and federal economic development partners on the foreign trade zone designation. And thanks to our region's director of economic development, Bob Segan, and his team for taking the leadership in this initiative. Such a designation will be valuable to Niagara's economy and complements the outreach that we've already undertaken with stakeholders and business from, get this, Colombia, Peru, China, and Costa Rica. And that's just this year. We also worked with our partners in Hamilton on the Pan Am Investment Playbook. The Pan Am Investment Playbook took place when we had the Pan Am Olympics or Games in the area, and we took advantage of all these people being in our area and what we could do to build, to foster and build partnerships with Latin American companies and our friends. The FTZ designation will enable us to build on these efforts by providing a single access window for a list of the following. Let me just touch on a few of them. Relief from taxes or duties on imports for processing and storing goods for export. Help with goods movement at the border. Access to business intelligence, including export research. Enable business to connect with peers, expertise, and other services to help increase sales abroad. So we're going to continue to work closely with our federal partners on approval for that designation, but stay tuned, maybe closer than you think. One more initiative I want to talk about is the 2021 Canada Games. And there he is, Councillor Rigby. The 2021 Games in February, Niagara Regional Council put its support behind the bid to host the 2021 Canada Summer Games. Council committed $85,000 to have the Niagara Sports Commission develop a formal bid proposal for the two-week competition. On our council, Tim Rigby moved the motion, and Henry D'Angela, chair of the commission and also a councillor, have been strong proponents for this exciting opportunity. Holding this event is going to draw about 5,000 athletes to our region and about 25,000 visitors. It's going to be huge. I would like to acknowledge a list of citizens who have agreed to sit on the bid committee on trying to get the games here in Niagara. From our regional council, Tim Rigby, Henry D'Angela, Bob Gale, Doug Hamilton, Tom Rankin, Peter Partridge Jr., David Veers, Tom Arkell, Neil Lumsden, Bob Segan, Liz Palmieri, Leanne Standrick, and Wade Stazer. How about a hand for these great folks? Absolutely, a strong and talented team for sure, and I'm looking forward to putting forward a strong bid that showcases Niagara as it needs to be. I want to talk just a little bit about some key team members of our at the region. As you know, our CAO, Harry Schlang, has recently accepted a new role in the growing city of Brampton. On behalf of Regional Council, I would like to thank Harry for his delivering his formula of change at the region and for his long record of service to the Niagara residents. Thank you. There's more. In working with Niagara Regional Council to foster an environment for economic prosperity, Harry made a significant organizational change in that will continue to propel our region forward. I'd like to thank Harry for his many contributions to Niagara and wish him every success in the future. As we look forward to another year of growth and building on success in 2015, there's an important player on the region's team that I'd like to acknowledge. On April 25th, we say goodbye to our Director of Economic Development, Bob Segan, who will be retiring at that time. Bob has been with us for about 2 years and has been a key player in our senior leadership team at the region. Bob's personal network has been invaluable to our work to drive the growth and economic development across Niagara. When it comes to opportunities and reaching out to the business community, Bob is my go-to person. While Bob will be retiring soon, I know that his efforts on our behalf will have a lasting impression for the region of Niagara. On behalf of Regional Council, I'd like to sincerely thank Bob for his work to drive economic prosperity in Niagara. How about a hand for Bob? I won't make you stand up, Bob. Don't worry. Oh. Moving forward. It's my privilege to highlight an announcement made in March that David Oakes has been selected as our new region's director of economic development. How about a hand for David? David has a long history of supporting small business in Niagara. He has more than 16 years in municipal management experience and has played a key role in establishing NGEN, the NIA, or Niagara Industrial Association, and Niagara Development Corridor Partnership. David comes to the region from the city of St. Catharines, where he held a number of roles, including more recently the Director of Recreation and Community Services. Before I conclude, I'd like to invite you to hear a few words from David on his vision and ideas for building on Bob's work for economic development in our region. Could you please roll the...
Well, probably the biggest thought I have right now is the shoes, the big shoes I have to fill. Even though Bob's, again, maybe a small man, he's got very large shoes when you talk about it from the broader sense to fill. Bob's really done a lot for Niagara. He's done a lot for the province, and I think those are really heavy and big footprints that I want to be able to help fill. The direction we're taking now is a good one. I think the fact that we have the municipalities all speaking as one, all focused on certain priorities, GO train, moving people, moving goods, all of that's great stuff. The next step in the process is really getting our message out to the world and really being able to showcase what we can do, what we have to offer, and getting Niagara back on the map and turning us into that economic powerhouse that we once were, and we will be moving forward. Well, the biggest story I think we have in Niagara is our people, is our collaboration, our communities, and our location. So when you look at Niagara, when you think of Niagara, you think of Niagara Falls, which is a great thing, but you also think about Brock University, you think about Niagara College, you think about the manufacturing that we do have. You think about our proximity to Toronto and Buffalo and all of those great assets. Hamilton, all of these things that we do have are huge strengths that we need to just continue to build on. And I think at the end of the day, what we're really going to be able to do is build on our people, and build on our resources, build on our infrastructure to really get us to the next step. And I know Bob really helped us lay the foundation for that. The biggest priority for me in the first 3-6 months is really to get a feel for the region. I've lived in the region, I've lived outside of the region, and my kids live in the region. And I think I know where we have come from, where we are today, and where we want to go in the future. Part of that is talking to people, talking to the municipalities, talking to the local economic development offices, talking to the business community, our institutions, our partners, the province, the feds, and really see where Niagara is positioned from their perspective and how we're going to help and work together to actually take the next step to really help us focus on the future. I'm really excited, looking forward to working with council to help move the dials, to help position us from a strategic standpoint to actually start to get to a different level of where we need to be. When we talk about moving people and goods, let's get to that next level. Let's become a leader in all of these different aspects. And we're trending in the right direction. And I hope that by working with the council, working with the chair's office, working with the local municipalities, our partnered institutions, we're only going to be able to make those dials move forward. And what I'm hoping is by the end of the next 3-5 years, those dials, we have to set new metrics because we blasted past where we want to go.
Thank you, David. I can't wait till you get to the region. Thank you. In conclusion, I just want to say that our region has a clear vision. We are increasingly aligned with our federal and provincial partners and our municipal colleagues. And you heard that with David just now. We are focused on shamelessly and proactively capitalizing on benefits that and opportunities that will benefit our region. We know that with housing prices in Hamilton rising and builders clamoring for space in Grimsby and West Lincoln, that the growth potential in Niagara is immense, and it's here now. We are dedicated to working for you, keeping costs down, providing outstanding service, and ensuring business and job creators have the tools and the environment for our local economy. We are laser focused on the future. Yes, there are distractions, and they are many. But we are laser focused on what we need to do as a region to make us successful and make sure that we are prepared for that economic prosperity that we so work for so hard. Thank you for listening to me today.
Thank you very much. If you still have a question card at your table and you would like us to pick it up, if I could ask you to just raise your hand. We have a couple of volunteers throughout the room here that actually would love to come and pick them up, and we'll try to address it. I would now like to welcome the VP of Public Relations with Enterprise Canada, Mr. Stephen Murdoch, to join Chair Caslin on stage for the Q&A session of today's luncheon. Since joining the firm in 2004, Stephen has spearheaded hundreds of public relations, media relations, and promotional projects, helping clients build their reputation and raise awareness of commercial and charitable initiatives. Please join me in welcoming Stephen.
Well, I think I speak for everybody in the hallway, and here I should say, if anybody was listening in the hallway. I'm excited as someone who spent the better part of 41 years here in Niagara, specifically St. Catharines, and as a father of two young boys, I'm excited about what you and council are doing and where we're headed, and I hope everybody would give them another round of applause for that. And excited to see where Niagara is, and more importantly, where Niagara is going. I thought today, since we're in Mayor Diodati's backyard, we'd start with a tourism question. The federal government has allocated, I believe, $50 million to tourism here in Niagara. What can the region be doing specifically so that tourism operators can tap into that and that we here in Niagara reap the benefits?
Thank you, Stephen. And firstly, I want to make a slight correction. It's not me that it creates economic prosperity in Niagara. It's you. So please give yourselves a hand for what you do to create economic prosperity in Niagara. That said, we talked about tourism and the money available. As you know, Niagara Falls is one of the seven wonders of the world. We attract 14 million, Jim, correct me, 14 million visitors a year to Niagara and growing. We have a lot to offer. The table stakes for getting visitors to Niagara are many. One is to have attractions that people want to come and see. The second is that we have a transportation system that facilitates people getting here when they need to. GO Train is going to be key to that. And let me tell you, when we talk about trying to get funding from our federal and provincial partners, it's not just us asking for a handout. It's us in competition with many, many others, all the other communities in Ontario and in Canada, when we're talking about federal, competing for those same dollars. We need to make sure that we put our best foot forward. And the best way to do that is the alignment that I talked about when I talked earlier. Making sure that we are aligned, that we do have our projects defined, our shovel-ready projects, as they call them, and that we are on the same page when it comes to what we need to do when we're talking to the federal and provincial governments. And I think if we do that, and what we have to offer in Niagara and the lake with our wineries, in West Niagara with our wineries there too, with our Niagara Falls, with all of our attractions, and think about it. What about Canadian Motor Speedway? What about CMS? You know, there's nowhere else in Canada that has a NASCAR track ever. So something like that or other projects that we're working on are surely going to play in our favor when it comes to attracting those tourism dollars.
Thank you. Like the other 449 people in this room, we want to grow Niagara. I want to see Niagara grow. I know folks at the tables want to see Niagara grow. What is it that the region can be doing to encourage more immigrants to want to settle here in Niagara? And what can we do? In my other hat, I actually teach at Niagara College, so it literally breaks my heart to see all these young people leaving, having to pack up, go to Toronto, go to Ottawa, go out west. What is it the region can be doing to attract more immigrants and to keep more young people here in Niagara?
Mm-hmm. Who thinks Niagara is a great place to live? Yeah. It's not a secret. It's not a secret. They know. Those table stakes that I talked about in transportation systems, affordable housing, absolutely. You know, all the things that make a community great are what we're trying to put together for Niagara, and we're doing it, and we're doing it well. As you can see, everybody enjoys living in Niagara, and when I talk to people outside the region, they all ask me about Niagara, and they call it the best-kept secret of the Golden Horseshoe, and I agree with them. I agree with them, and it's something that we need to keep working on and keep creating those opportunities for the young people on, you know, when we work on engagement with our young people, when we work on engagement and putting young people together with employers and creating job opportunities from them, that's going to be the catalyst for them to stay. We have to have jobs, we have to have conditions that transportation systems, housing, and the rest of what takes to put together a community successful for our young people to want to stay here.
You talked a little bit about 0% budget. What, in all likelihood, could we replicate that next year? And I guess what's that going to mean for the lower tier municipalities mm-hmm. here in Niagara?
So 0% budget is let's not take that lightly. That is something significant and took a lot of work on staff, the great staff at Niagara Region's part, on pulling that together. It's not easy to do, but we did it. So, you know, I'm thankful for the work that we did. And moving forward, we need to balance. We need to balance our infrastructure needs, our roads and our bridges and our sewers and our water and our police and so on. We need to balance those things. If we continue on a 0% budget year after year, we're simply going to watch those things erode, and we're not going to be able to have the community that we're looking for. We need to be reasonable in our ask, but at the same time, we need to be frugal when it comes to savings and efficiencies wherever we can find them. If we can find enough efficiencies, absolutely, 0% is on the docket. If we can't, then we're not going to let our community erode in order to achieve that.
Good. Affordable housing. We all watch the media landscape here in Niagara, from Fort Erie out to Grimsby and in between. Affordable housing, you touched on it during your presentation. Affordable housing is very, very important. What is it Niagara can be doing more of to ensure that we have more affordable housing? Mm-hmm. And what role do you see the local construction industry playing when it comes to affordable housing?
Affordable housing is a significant initiative. It's part of our strategic plan. It's part of our six pillars that we're looking to reduce our housing wait list. Right now, it's somewhere between 5,500 and 6,000 people waiting on a wait list for housing. Nothing's more important to people on getting themselves settled than having a roof over their head, and it's important to us. That's why it's on our strategic plan. The way we've done business in the past is simply not working. We're not getting enough houses built. We need to make sure that we can accommodate not only the wait list, but those in need in the future too. So we need to look at other ways to develop these housing opportunities. You know, I talked about different ways to do business mm-hmm. when we talk about business at the region, whether it's in partnership with developers or builders or other means that we can find to find a multiplication factor on our efforts to make sure that we get that housing wait list down. My goal over this term is, and I haven't said it publicly before, my goal over this term is 1,000. So I want to get 1,000 units down.
In terms of, I'm glad you touched on the construction industry, is there any room for harmonization when it comes to a lot of these fees, when it comes to permits and building standards, developments? Is this something that the region could coordinate or play a leading role in?
Mm-hmm. Red tape. Who likes red tape? Anybody? Anybody like red tape? Any of those builders like red tape out there? Probably not. Nobody likes red tape, and it's our goal to try and cut that red tape. And to do that, we need to make sure that our systems are as efficient as possible and that we're working closely with our municipal partners at the cities and towns, as well as with the region. Let's face it, we each have our own responsibilities when it comes to what our role is in making sure that systems are built adequately, that we have enough checks and balances in the construction process. You know, it's something that we need to continue to work together with the communities, with the municipalities, and make sure that we've got our systems as efficient as possible to make sure there's no overlap and there's no underlap, and that we're working together to make it as smooth as possible for the investors and the builders in our community.
Question from the audience, and a very good one. What are your plans for the Niagara District Airport? Where do you see that headed?
Yeah, exciting, exciting opportunity. You know, I talked about Porter. If I could just expand on that story a little bit. When the mayors and I went to visit Porter, the one thing I talked about with Robert DeLuce is making the Niagara District Airport somewhere that they could service their planes and call it a parking lot. So a Porter Airlines service bay and parking lot. And he just looked at me and just smiled. And he said, man, I didn't think of that one. And I said, yeah, just imagine, it's an 8-minute flight from Niagara to Toronto Island Airport. Just think of what that would do for you if you parked your aircraft in Niagara overnight, and what kind of a commuter service that would make for you in flying from Niagara to Toronto Island, and how many people you would attract in doing that. Think of the catchment area that would be. You know, people would drive from Hamilton down to Niagara to catch that flight to Toronto Island Airport, rather than getting in their cars and driving on that horrendous highway from Hamilton to Toronto. They'd get there faster, let's face it. So anyways, it was an interesting opportunity that we had with Bob DeLuce and Porter. But developing our airport is part of our transportation master plan. It's part of a system that we need as a community, we need to make work. There are two airports in Niagara, the South Airport and the Niagara District Airport. Both are required. It's a system that we have to have in order to make ourselves successful to attract a commercial carrier in Niagara. We're spending a lot of time and energy on trying to do that. We will continue to do that as part of our plan going forward. I didn't want to talk about it today, but you guys, you got it out of me.
Another great question from the crowd. Where is the region at in terms of, or is there any movement that you've heard of about reestablishing a Niagara-based canning facility for fresh produce?
Niagara-based canning facility. You know, let's face it, we're one of the only places left on the planet that grows tender fruit. I mean, it's a miracle that we have such access in Niagara and it hasn't been exploited more than it normally is. I think it's a wonderful idea. It's going to take the community, it's going to take the business community to want to do that. And I would encourage and I would support anybody that stepped up and said, let's make Niagara great again as the garden, you know, as a fruit community, a fruit and vegetable community. Because quite frankly, you just don't find five Great Lakes collected together in such close proximity, creating an environment for tender fruit as we have here. There's nowhere else in the world like it. Nowhere else in the world. It's something that we need to exploit.
Have the folks at the region considered more P3 programs and alternative service delivery for the region, regional services?
Yeah, so I talked about that quite a bit in my speech, so I won't go over it again. But, you know, creating those collaborations with business such as yourself, are important. It allows us to it's a multiplication effect. It allows us to use your resources, employ your services, but to our benefit, to the community's benefit. So absolutely, it's something that we need to continue to look at. And it's based on relationships, it's based on trust, it's based on working together with the business community and our investors and builders in Niagara. And yes, we will be doing that.
Excellent. And probably, well, our last question and probably the most important question of this afternoon actually comes courtesy of Anita Caslin. And Anita wants to know, what is for dinner tonight?
Well, that one I can't answer because I don't cook.
Excellent. Well, I appreciate it. Thank you for your time. And I think the folks in the other 449 folks in the room appreciate it. Kudos to you and your council. You're doing wonderful work. And everybody, all your support staff, you should be commended. So
thank you, Steve. Thank you.
Gentlemen, if you can give us just 1 second before leaving the stage, I would like to introduce Adriana Decker with the Niagara Regional Broadband Network for a few words of thanks.
Thank you, Chair Caslin. That was a wonderful speech and very enlightening. It's amazing to hear about all the initiatives that you're working on, and I know that's just a tidbit. So I would say a round of applause for Chair Caslin and his team and his hard work, 2016-15. So Niagara Regional Broadband, many of you might not know what that stands for, but that is Niagara Regional Broadband Network. We are your municipally owned telecommunications provider in the region, wholly owned by municipal shareholders. And as Mr. Caslin alluded to, is alignment. We are totally aligned in the region of Niagara. For those of us who are also moved by Mr. Watson Penn Financial video that was played earlier today, I couldn't have said it any better than myself. That is what Niagara Regional Broadband is. We are your local telecommunications provider. We know our customers by name. Niagara Region is the only region that we service, and it's all that we do. In fact, 2 years ago when we bid on Mr. Watson's business, I think that's what brought it home for Mr. Watson is the fact that we are truly your community-based provider, and our best interests are here in the region. So if we can't do business right here in Niagara, we can't do it anywhere, and we wouldn't rather do it anywhere else. So thank you for your time, and thanks again, Mr. Caslin, the GNCC, and all the chambers for their hard work today and putting together a great event.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for attending this afternoon. Just before we leave, please join me in some words of appreciation again to our host, ScotiaBank Convention Centre, delicious lunch. and our sponsors, Penn Financial Credit Union and Bell, Subaru Niagara, Niagara Immigrant Connections Initiative, Niagara Regional Broadband Network, BEC, Soundbox Productions, and our media sponsors, Post Media, which is the Standard, Review and Tribune, TV Kojiko, and Janice and Robin Digital Communication. Thank you for all of your help and assistance. Next year's State of the Region, mark it in your calendars, is March 22nd, 2017. And one last housekeeping item. Would the board chairs and executive directors, all the chambers and business association, please partner with us today, please come together for a photo opportunity on my right, on your left. And please spend some time networking. Enjoy with the rest of your day. Thank you.